your son went to the resurrection in a few days. And that is truly being concerning. We know that even though we will surely stumble, that you tell us that we will walk, if we walk in your light, as you are in the light, we will have true fellowship with you and with one another as the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin. I just pray that you would bring your light into this room today at each table. Just thank you today for leads to us, that your love is seen and your grace is demonstrated, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. business in Burlington, Iowa, was closed for 3 days of prayer during a revival that swept across our nation. And we ask you, Father God, for revival in our time and in our region. Please do it again, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Church was done last year, but we believe that God still wants us to exist, still wants us to serve Him faithfully, and believe that He's going to provide so that we can continue to serve Him. I want to close with this verse, Matthew 25, verses 34 and 36. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me." This is why we do what we do. God's love and grace is to be extended to all people, because we are all sinners, saved by grace, through the perfect act of Jesus Christ's sacrificial love, which was done 2,000 years ago on this day. And not for those who are in our jails, we need to know that message, just like the rest of the world. And you're even doing that. So thank you for your prayer. Thank you for your churches that are supporting us. And thank you for your gifts. And God bless you in your wonderful Resurrection Sunday.
To consider how you make your gift. You can put all of that back on the envelope.
Sure.
myself in other areas of my life. By the time I graduated from college, I was ready to come into the world as an athlete, personally and emotionally. I was very vulnerable and wanted to trust anyone who was going to prop me up or to make me feel good. So between my college graduation in 1997 and 2005, I became involved in two high-profile relationships. At that time, I said they ignored a lot of red flags in my life, and I wanted someone strong to take care of me like I thought my father should have. I'm no psychologist, and once more, this is hindsight, but I think that just like some guys like to marry someone who mothers them, like their mother does, I wanted someone to be like how I thought my father should have been. I was talented and driven, but I needed to feel secure. What I didn't understand at that time was that this journey in my soul was something that no man could do for me. Something that I couldn't even do for myself. Only God could fill that void. So earlier I spoke about how hard my mom worked to give me certain opportunities in life. My mom was very much a woman of integrity and principle. And so she definitely taught me the difference between right and wrong. Right, and I grew up in a strong religious environment. We were not the type of family who went to church often. Vacation Bible school during the summers. I knew some of my stories, but my faith, my personal relationship with God was pretty basic and mostly non-existent. I prayed a bit from time to time, but there was no real foundation for me. And as I grew older, I didn't understand how important a relationship with God was to living a balanced life and to really living out my true purpose in life. And it certainly wasn't ready for me. So it's definitely not putting myself around people or situations that brought me closer to God. In a sense, to me, God was there, but he wasn't there. But after I had my first child, Monty, in 2003, things started to slowly change in my life. As many of us know, when we have kids, the priorities certainly shift when we have kids. And I started praying more about how to raise them right, but my relationship with God was still daily personal and professional life. I was still living with me as the focus. I was trying to protect the barrier that had allowed to take over my life. Successful, I had it all together. But even after all the fame, money, the magazine covers, endorsements, the accolades, and the awards, my inner struggles didn't just disappear. I was publicly projecting this confident and this strong image. My issues were still very actively undermining the children. And I tried to keep running away from the truth of the pain that I never really understood, that I was too afraid to actually look at. But I was running out of time and the resources to keep up the masquerade. I was hurting, but I didn't want to publicly, or for that matter, privately admit it. So it's funny, well, like I say, it's sad, funny how we can know that something is not right with us, but we are too proud, ashamed, lazy, or stubborn to get help. And back then, I didn't understand how that it was probably the Holy Spirit making me restless, because he wanted my attention. I really didn't know how to discern or respond to his voice. And so I followed for a few more years in the dark. But thankfully, the Lord didn't give up on me. By the time that my second son, Amir, was born in June 2007, my life had begun to change drastically. Earlier that year, I married a wonderful man, and I moved from North Carolina to his hometown. In Texas, where I reside now. I began going to the local church, my church there, for sure, a lot of Christians there, and my relationship with God started to grow. And I knew I had a long way to go in that department. I was taking baby steps, but I was had probably seen me on the news or in the news, but today I was just married. Lon's going to be his mom. We're married and they're meeting. And for the first time in years, I enjoyed just being a regular person without having to meet Mary and Jones all the time. But even as all these new positive and good things were happening in my life, they were forming the baggage of my issues. A series of poor choices had finally caught up with me. I was no longer the media darling that the federal government was prescribing a lie to them. I pled guilty both to those charges in October of 2007 and I was sentenced to 6 months in incarceration, 2 years probation. Never in a thousand years did I guess that I would go to prison. The slow but very potent downward spiral of my life and being the top female athlete in the world to a convicted felon was an indescribably painful and embarrassing one. And even then, God was with me. And even though, like Samson, I was the one who ultimately had made the choices that got me into trouble and brought me so low and caused me to lose so much, God thankfully wasn't finished with me yet. And in March of 2008, I began serving my time at a female prison in one right outside of Dallas, Fort Worth, called Carswell. And it wasn't, I like to say, it wasn't like one of those hardcore locked-up shows that you see on MSNBC, but it was far from a country club. Prison was rough, but being there actually transformed my life. Even though at a time, my time in Carswell was relatively short compared to other inmates. The 49 days that I spent in solitary confinement was one of the most profound and life-changing times in my life. Being locked up by yourself in a 12-by-12 cell for 23 hours a day, and sometimes 24 hours a day, if a guard didn't want to escort you outside for that 1 hour of recreational time round into the corridor. Not seeing my husband, not being able to talk with my boys on their birthdays because my visitation and telephone privileges were taken away almost broke me. It was beyond hard to study that much time by yourself, physically confined, unable to reach out to a familiar face or a gentle touch, or even just to have a regular conversation with somebody. My presence was way beyond anything I would have ever imagined or even wished on my enemy. Many nights I was close to the edge, wondering how I had gotten myself into this situation. I look at pictures of my family and wonder why I had made certain poor choices and messed up my life completely. But God was there with me, and they only allow you to keep a few personal items while you're in prison. For example, I was able to keep a carry God slowly began to show me that, like the psalmist says in Psalms 139, he was there with me wherever I went. Even in the depths of my despair in prison, he was there with me. And more than that, he let me know that I was fearfully and wonderfully made, because he made me. He knew my thoughts even before I knew them. He knew that I would mess up big time even before I messed up. He loved me enough to visit me right there in that small room in the midst of my fears, my self-loathing, and my self-doubt. He was teaching me that when people who I relied on weren't there or couldn't do anything to help me, that he was the one who would sustain me. He was the only one who could offer hope in that darkness. He was the father that I had longed for all of my life. And he was the peace that passes all understanding. Probably the hardest part of all was learning to finally forgive myself. And all of this, it was easier to accept that God forgave me because he's God. That's nothing for him to do. It's just what he does. But it wasn't natural for me to do that for myself, even though I mentally knew that once he forgave me, then I could go ahead and do the same for myself. And I'll be honest, it's still a process, especially when I think of the pain and the hurt that I caused so many of my family and my friends. But I've learned, I shouldn't phrase that much. I've been learned that not forgiving others leaves you bitter, but not forgiving yourself actually leaves you paralyzed. You can never walk forward in your purpose if you don't fully accept Christ's work of forgiveness and reconciliation on the cross. And that means accepting that you need to forgive and love yourself too. I'm not talking about the self-love that leads us to become beheaded and to sin. We're talking about the love for ourselves that comes from our God working in our hearts. I'm speaking about the self-love that comes from God's love, which is shed abroad in our hearts. That love that caused the Word to be made flesh and to dwell among us. That love which the Bible says he showed us while we were yet sinners. By dying on the cross for us to have a relationship with the Father. That love which, because he first loved us, we are able to live and express his love back to him and toward others. It's one of the themes that my pastor keeps reminding us over and over in our church, because Christ's sacrifice is all about his love for us, despite ourselves. At the time that I was finally released from Carswell in September of 2008, my faith had grown tremendously. Not that I can quote the whole Bible type of faith, which I still can't do, but the God loves me despite myself type of faith. The faith that all things work together for good for those that love God and are called by him. The faith that the Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want, and that even though I walk through the valley of the valley of death, he's there with me, that he's a very present help in a time of storm. The faith that I can call him Father and know that he always has my back. He's my protector and he's my provider. The faith that lets me know that I don't need to have it all together for him to love me and to be gracious to me. But I also made it through because of the loving support of my family and my close friends who stayed behind me, even though I had disappointed them. The supporters from around the world took time to write a gracious note while I was in prison of encouragement, which helped me make it through some of the darkest days of my life. Once again, I realized that God uses people to encourage us along our faith journey, even at times people we don't even know. Many of the women in prison also helped and inspired me, because they saw silver linings in their dark days and their rainy days, and they could still trace God's hand through their very difficult circumstances. So when I left Carswell, although I knew that I wanted to somehow show my appreciation to them and to help others not follow a destructive path in life, as I had done, I was also worried of being burnt again by the media and putting myself out there. I had been there and done that, and I really didn't feel like taking that part of the focus on the things in our lives, like amp up our fears, like past sin, self-doubt, and whatever else we can use to get our eyes off of God's work. And His plan for us, He knows that once we spend time looking at ourselves, our circumstances, and not at God, then God's love is manifested in Christ's love for us and His blessings toward each of us every day. It doesn't become the central driving force in our lives. The enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy by getting us to shift our attention away from God's love, because he knows that once we tap into God's love, well, we better watch out. And God's wisdom and His guidance and His protection will allow us to access that abundant life. Any situation that we face, we make that decision whether faith or fear will rule in our lives. There's really nothing in between. Most of our problems come from some sort of fear in our lives, which really is a lack of faith. Even as I stand here, there are still some, actually there's many areas of my life that I need greater faith in, many areas where fear is still dominant. But God knows this, and He's patiently, thankfully, helping me to take my hands off of certain situations or to move out of the way so that He can pour His love into them. And heal it properly. And then beyond some of that stuff really hurts. You know, I'm trying to keep certain painful and shameful areas covered, even for him to try. Sometimes I allow the enemy to keep my mind on the past or my present circumstances in life that are only how I have hoped and not on God's redemptive resurrection power. Some days I feel like I'm clear and truly, and I feel like a failure as a mother or a wife or a child of God, and yet I'm still very much a work in progress, as I'm telling you, but God's still working on me and loving on me. Earlier I spoke about how my sins and my choices brought me low, but thankfully God still had work for me to do. I've been given a second chance, and thankfully the final chapter in my life is not done. Since my release from Carswell, God has opened up so many doors for me to play professional basketball in the WNBA, to speak all around the world, various churches, schools, organizations, and conferences all over the country. I even traveled overseas with the U.S. State Department to share my team of written message and story of redemption and hope in Serbia and Croatia. God has helped me to see and accept that beyond my athletic talents, heaven was given this gift to speak and encourage others along their own journey. God, it's easy for me to talk in front of people, but not always easy for me to open up and talk about my mistakes and my failures. However, I do it because I know I have a purpose beyond winning competitions or being a great athlete. Looking back, I now realize that sports actually gave me a platform to really do what I'm supposed to be doing. That's why this celebration of Good Friday and Easter Sunday means so much to me, because I'm reminded both of God's love and His resurrection power, especially after all that I've been through. Only God has the ability to raise from the dead. He raised us as believers who were lost and dead in sin to experience new life in Christ. It raises dead bones and broken pieces and frustrated dreams to life again. He raises struggling relationships and marriages, and He breathes new life into circumstances where our human strength can't. Christ's death and resurrection means that death has lost its sting. And the grave has lost its victim. With a word of prayer and encouragement for those of you who, like me, have messed up, or who may be facing a storm in their own lives. We live in proof that God is able to take broken pieces and put your life back together. If you can make it through your storms or your darkest days, if you can get past bad relationships and poor choices, by His grace. appears to be lost forever can be found in you in Christ. He proved that he conquered death on the cross 2,000 years ago, and he's still in the business of applying his resurrection power and faith in Jesus Christ to remember whatever we may be facing. And to those of you who have never invited Christ into your life as Lord and Savior, I want you to know that God is able to forgive you and to restore. He really wants to. Christ came to bridge that gap of sin between us and God the Father, so we can have a relationship with Him and be able to experience His indescribable love for us. And do you think that you've ever experienced love before? It's not vain until you've experienced God's love that day and accept Him as Lord and Savior. Once again, I want to thank the organizers. Thank you. Participating and giving me the opportunity to share as part of my testimony, baptizing. Thank you. pleased here that I'm able to share with you all this morning.